Well, good morning and welcome to our service of worship at Broadway First Baptist Church for Sunday, August the 18th, 2024. Reuben, can you hear me? Okay. People on Zoom, I can't see any faces, so I can't tell if there's any fingers up or down. I'll have to go with yes. My name is Susan Stevenson, and I am your service host for today. As we begin our service, let us take time to acknowledge that we are located on Treaty One land and to give thanks for all those who have served as stewards of this land in time gone by. May we continue to grow our treaty relationship with them, and may we welcome all who join us in worship this morning in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And a special welcome to our visitors, Barb, Wanda, and Sandy. Over here, say hi afterwards. Today we welcome Rachel Duick as our pianist. Also contributing to our worship this morning will be Gay Miller, who will lead us in prayer, John Hunt, who will read the scripture, and Pastor Charlene McAlpin, who will bring us this morning's message, and Sheila Mitchell Duick, who is our intrepid Zoom tech. Announcements are fairly sparse. Today is the long-awaited barbecue at Charlene and Hanny's. The address is included in the bulletin. Did the phone number get in there too? No. Talk to Charlene if you're worried that you might get lost on the route. There are also maps if anybody didn't pick up one last week or forgot to bring theirs. There's a couple more over there. And if we need any more, speak to me and I will run them off. We notice that there's a long list of people who need rides, as well as a list of people who are willing to give rides. So if you need a ride or you can give a ride, if you meet in the lounge or just outside the lounge following the service, we'll make sure that everybody gets a ride there and presumably a ride back. There's no coffee this morning following the service, unfortunately, but we don't want anybody to get stuck behind doing dishes. So next week is the deadline for the September newsletter. If you have any submissions for the newsletter, please send them to the email address that's indicated in the bulletin. We were sorry this week to learn that Alan McCracken's younger brother, Greg, died suddenly last Wednesday of a heart attack in Tweed, Ontario. We express our sympathies and condolences to Alan and his family and ask that you hold them in prayer at this time. Let us now call ourselves to worship. Come, let us praise God together in the company of his gathered people. For the works of our God are unparalleled. Everything he does reveals his glory and majesty. Our God is full of grace and mercy, and his righteousness never fails. So come and worship, all you who revere the Lord, for reverence and awe is the foundation of true wisdom. Amen. Let us join together to sing our first hymn, All the Way My Savior Leads Me. It's number 699 in the Book of Praise or up on the screen behind us. Thank you.
Will you bow in prayer with me? Gracious Heavenly Father, as we gather here this morning with hearts full of praise, hearts full of hope, we thank you for being with us each step of the way. Our sins are forgiven. Your gospel has nourished us in our daily lives, and we have been refreshed and we'll be ready to face a new week. Thank you, God, for your gifts of eternity. We pray, Lord, for those who are with us on Zoom and for all who cannot be with us. May the love, joy, and peace that meets us here be theirs, regardless of their situations. As children of God, we extend these thoughts and prayers. We also are so enriched by your presence with us. Our hearts go out to our dear friend Alan this morning and his family as they mourn the loss of his brother. We bring in our prayers the lives of those who lead in our country. We read in Isaiah, energy and insights of justice to those who guide and decide, strength and prowess to those who guard and protect. To people who are living in dreadful conditions of war and unrest, to all who are experiencing floods, famine, and the huge fires that have devastated so many people's homes, property, and wildlife. We are so enriched by your presence with us. There are many who do not have the beauty of your peace as we do this morning. Give them strength and courage, Lord, and the hopes that one day their strain and stress will be over. As we go forth this day, we shall trust steadily in you, that all we do and say will be a reflection of your great love and peace in our lives. Your faithful covenant we lean on and go forth in joy. With our Pastor Charlene, we all go forth with your strength and wisdom and with the peace that only you can give. We will remain safe in your everlasting arms. In Jesus' precious name we pray, amen.
Thank you, Gay. Let us now join our voices to sing the great Welsh hymn, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah, or as it appears at number 651 in the Book of Praise, Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer. Whichever way you sing it, it's an awesome hymn.
Thank you.
You knew the first verse without even looking at the words. We'll invite John to come with this morning's scripture reading.
Our scripture this morning is John 6, 51 to 58. And in 1980, when my parents gave me this Bible, it was called the New International Version. I don't know what it's called in 2024, but it was quite a few years ago. I guess when it comes to God, everything is new, isn't it? When it's so recently. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If a man eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Then the Jews began to argue sharply among themselves. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth. Unless you eat the fresh flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him. Thanks to God.
Let's pray. Dear God, we ask your blessing on Charlene this morning as she brings us your message. Fill her with the Holy Spirit and open our hearts that we may all be blessed by what we hear. Amen.
Thank you, and good morning to all. Thank you for joining us on another beautiful summer day, which comes with sunshine and haze. But we are very thankful, of course, for our opportunity to worship together and to share in learning from God's Word. I'm again in the lectionary. I'm surprising myself by every time I open up the lectionary for each week and how wonderfully chosen the verses are, and how they all really work together well in telling us the story of God's people. And so today, in the lectionary, one of the Old Testament readings is from 1 Kings. And I mean, I'm not going to read it now, but it's, again, we were in 1 Kings last week, if you were here with us, and it's an interesting story. I mean, of course, not unlike any story that you would hear anywhere else, that you would tune into on television or online, of course, or even our own personal stories, if you think back and what transpired, what happened with your aunt so-and-so, or something that happened to a cousin. They're very interesting stories. And so when we're looking at this story, of course, in 1 Kings chapter 2, it's talking about Solomon's ascension to the throne. So before this, King David, the one that we're all very familiar with and that God had his hand on for his reign, he's come to the end of his life. And of course, God had promised that the line of David would continue to rule. And so Solomon, his son, is now coming to the throne. And he's getting blessed. David is giving him a blessing. And in 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 12, the last thing is very comforting that they say, that Solomon sat on the throne of his father David, and his kingdom was firmly established. And so up until that point, it sounds like, okay, well, David had a rocky road when he was king, but now that Solomon's here, well, Solomon's going to have a firm grip on that ruling class, and he's going to take care of God's people. Of course, going through the story, we find that there is a bit of jostling for that position. There were other children, other sons that were thinking they were more able to take the throne, but as we carry on throughout the story, we find that Solomon is able to maintain his hold as king. And so when we come to chapter 3, which is what's in the lectionary, chapter 3 tells us about Solomon's request to God, as he's so grateful for being given this opportunity to rule. And in chapter 3, verse 3, you'll see what happens. Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of his father David, except that he sacrificed and burned incense to the high places. Now that he was king, he went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was a great high place. Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. And at Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask, what shall I give you?" Ask, what shall I give you? God is in fact giving Solomon a blank check. Whatever you want, just ask and I'll provide it for you. Now, of course, reading and hearing a story like that, you'll put yourself in that place and you'll say, oh, if that was me, you know, I've got a list. I've got lots of things that I would ask. If God's going to give me anything I want, I've got things to ask for. In fact, we've got a Disney example. Again, I'm a grandmother, so a lot of my movies are Disney movies, kids' movies. But in Disney, they have a movie called Aladdin. And in that story, Aladdin is given the same type of opportunity, 3 wishes from a genie. And of those 3 wishes, he thinks, I don't know, what should I ask for? And he turns to the genie and he asks the genie, what would you ask for? What kind of wishes would you need to have that come for you to be happy? And we see that Solomon does a similar type of thing here, in that what he asks for is not what we would have expected, what any of us maybe would have done. In fact, what Solomon asks for is wisdom. He turns back to God and he says, thank you. I'm going to paraphrase here, but he thanks him for the opportunity. He thanks him for giving him this wish, if you will, to fulfill. And so he says, in humility, can I have wisdom? Can I know the best for your people? Because he realizes that being the king of Israel is a king of great power. And so he asks for wisdom. And then in our lectionary story, because it stops there and it kind of gives us a chance to really think about that, and we go over into Proverbs. And if we go over into Proverbs chapter 9, I'll give you a little bit, the first 6 verses. Wisdom has built her house. She has hewn out her 7 pillars. She has slaughtered her meat. She has mixed her wine. She has also furnished her table. She has sent out her maidens. She cries from the highest places of the city. Whoever is simple, let him turn in here. As for him who lacks understanding, she says to him, come, eat my bread and drink the wine that I have mixed. Forsake foolishness and live, and go in the way of understanding. What a beautiful picture that we're given here from Solomon. Yes, Solomon did write the first 9 Proverbs that we have in our Bible, and here he talks about wisdom. And I would think that this is shortly after God appeared to him and asked him what he wanted, and he said he'll take wisdom, and he writes this beautiful poem about how wisdom asks us to come. Wisdom invites us in. Wisdom has prepared things for us. Verse 2, she has slaughtered her meat. She has prepared an animal, maybe a lamb to the slaughter. She has mixed her wine and set a table, maybe prepared a feast. What I thought was really interesting about that line there is the 23rd Psalm that many of us are very familiar with. And in Psalm 23, verse 5, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Sorry, that's verse 4. Verse 5, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup runs over. So some very vivid pictures of being full and being prepared for that you are an important guest, and that what God has for us, or what wisdom has for us, is overflowing. It's so much more than we could even accept. Our cups are running over. And so moving on, humility has asked us to forsake evil, forsake foolishness, to live. So that's the first step towards wisdom, is to let go of your own ideas, your own foolishness, the things that you don't really understand, and ask wisdom to bring it to you. In Ephesians, Paul talks about that. And Ephesians is also another verse in the lectionary. In Ephesians chapter 5, in verse 17, therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Again, that connection between letting go of your foolishness, letting go of your misunderstandings, and allowing wisdom to come in. Understand what the Lord has for you. In fact, James, it's not in the lectionary, this is something that came to mind while I was reading these verses. In James chapter 1, verse 5, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives to all liberally, without reproach, and it will be given to you. So, as the story of the lectionary unfolds, that Solomon, great king, asks God for wisdom, God is able to provide for him, and we can learn from that when we let go of our own understanding, which is so very limited, and we give in to allow God to give us his understanding. The question is, how do we hear from God? How do we know what God has for us? How do we gain that wisdom? And there is our verses that we've read today. In John's gospel, we hear about Jesus, who is the bread of life. Now, he also preached a sermon that we read about in Matthew's gospel. In Matthew chapter 5, another famous one, chapter 5, verse 6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. And Jesus, in our verses in John, tells us that he is that fulfillment. He is that bread and that wine that is fulfilling our hunger and thirst for righteousness. Now let's take a little bit of context into our verses in John chapter 6, that we see here that Jesus has, at the beginning of chapter 6, he's gone over to the Sea of Galilee. And at this time, there's many people who've heard about him, lots who want to hear from him. So he's followed by a great multitude. Many people are after him and they want to hear what he has to say and they want to be close to him. And so he sees them and he realizes, you know what? They're going to be hungry. So he turns to his disciples and he says, okay, where shall we get bread to feed this many people? And the verses tell us in chapter 6, verse 6, he said this to test him, for he himself knew what he would do. So he's asking his disciples, come on into what's happening here. And, you know, what are we going to do about these people? We've got a multitude, let's say 5,000 people here, and they're going to want to eat. What are we going to do? And of course, his disciples, using their own understanding, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them. We don't even have enough money to buy enough bread to feed these people. But one disciple, Andrew, says, well, there is a child here. He brought him his lunch. And in his lunch, there's, you know, some fish. He's got 5 loaves of bread and 2 small fish. But what can that do? Jesus says, make the people sit down, bring me the lunch. And we know that he blessed it and broke the bread, gave it to the disciples, and the people were fed so much so that there was left over. The bread and the fish filled the people to more than they needed. And so this is what's just happened. And in fact, after this, they go out on the Sea of Galilee, and Jesus stays back to talk to the people. The disciples go onto the water, and as night falls, of course, Jesus comes to them on the water. So he's walking on the water, and he's speaking to his disciples. And of course, they're afraid at first, but once they see him and he comes into the boat, they realize this is a great man. This is not just any ordinary man. And so now we come towards our verses here, and the people who were on the other side of the sea, now they're over where Jesus and the disciples are, and they're saying, you need to give us more bread, man. This was great. Feed us. Tell us about your greatness. And Jesus gets a little bit, I don't want to say upset, but he's at the point now where, you know, it's time to learn something. It's time for you to hear and take in what my role is here on earth. And he says that I am the bread of life. Now, there was a little back and forth that they talked about. You know, there was our ancestor Moses, who had given us bread from heaven, the manna, when we were out in the wilderness and we were wandering and we were hungry, that Moses did that for us. And Jesus has to correct them. And his correction is that it wasn't Moses that gave them the manna, it was God. And that God, your Father, gives you this living bread, which is my body, which is me. I am from God, and I am sacrificing myself for you to have everlasting life, to have that wisdom, to have that connection and relationship with God, who wants to give more than anything than we could ever want or imagine. So although he's given these people, these followers, some wonderful advice. We carry on a few verses afterwards. We find that it was too hard for some people to accept. And of those 5,000 and maybe more followers, people who were wanting to hear from Jesus, many of them fell away. And in fact, he turned to his own 12 followers. disciples and said, "Are you going to leave me too?" And our friend Peter, who's also, like many of us, impetuous, and he'll just say what's on his mind, he said, "Where are we going to go? If we don't follow you, we have nowhere else to go." And I think that does bring us back to fast forward to now and to our lives and to our needing and wanting that bread. We're looking, we're hungry, and we're thirsty for righteousness. I mean, I try not to look at the news or open social media too far to hear about the unrest that's going on in the world, that's going on even in our city. Even something as wonderful as the Olympic Games, which is to celebrate unity and bringing together of the world, there were many unrighteous and unfair things that seem to have come to the light during something like that. So in our lives, even today, just like they were in Jesus' time, there's unrest. There's unrighteousness. There's unfairness. There's sin in the world. And we're all living through it. But Jesus says, "I am the bread and the drink for your hunger and thirst. Lean into me." And as I said at the beginning here, that it was really interesting to find how the lectionary put these verses together so that we could see this story, to see this lesson of eternal life, this lesson of how to be filled to beyond capacity, is to lean in on Jesus. And to lean in on Jesus means to be in his word. That means we're reading and studying and praying daily to find out, what does God really have in mind for us? Where does God want us to go today? Who does he want us to speak to today? The Bible gives us that. Prayer helps us focus that. And relationship. Being here in a place like church this morning is a wonderful way to start a relationship, to build a relationship within these walls, within these words in the Bible. But don't stop just on Sundays. Feel free to speak to your friends and your neighbors and your family about this wonderful word of God that talks about his giving. Giving to us all that we need, more than we need, so much more that we're sharing it with the world. Yes, there is unrest. Yes, it seems unfair what's happening around us or to us. But God is there with us. And God has provided for us a way to carry on, to carry through, to be a blessing to those around us. I ask you today to take some time. I mean, there's wonderful Proverbs, and the first 9 chapters of Proverbs, as I've said, has been written by King Solomon. If you want to take some time this week, choose one of them and read it daily. Take some time to let the Spirit fill you and tell you and lead you throughout your week. And let's see if that doesn't bring a little more sunshine and happiness to those around us. Amen? So now we're to sing a song that will remind us again that it's God that gives us the life, that God protects us and provides for us daily. It is "Breathe on Me, Breath of God," in the Book of Praise, number 389, and as well on the screen.
Breathe on me, breath of God, fill me with
And now, may the breath of God be upon you all, and that you would be filled with the bread of life, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.